Podcasting live from across the United States, this is the Multitapped Podcast.
Hey everybody, and welcome to episode 25 of the Multitapped Podcast. Tonight we are going to be talking about metal, and I really like the lineup that I have going on here tonight. Some good folks, so let's go ahead and introduce them. First off, joining us for the third week in a row, and I told you guys he was going to be here for some good episodes, is Avalanche Jared. Then, of course, we have Nico the Wii Guy joining us again, because can't do a music episode without Nico. That's just blaspheme. And then, finally, we have Westapo joining us again.
What's up?
Though, I'm going to be completely honest, man. I don't think I'm ever going to train my brain to not think Westapo the second I see the name. Literally every time. It's the worst thing in the world.
But yeah, just call me Wes. It's all good.
Yeah, that's good, too. But Colorado love, all that jazz. Anyways, though, when we were talking about what music episodes we wanted to do in the future, metal was the first one that came up because there are a lot of metalheads in the group. I know, hard to believe, right? Tough sell. No one would buy that. But looking at this lineup, I think, and we were talking a little bit about this too, I think we all have different tastes in the genre. We all seem to like different things. So out of curiosity, and I don't know, if you can't come up with a specific answer, that's fine. I always come up with some on-the-spot bullshit opening question. But what would you say was your first real exposure to the genre? What like, introduced you to metal? What about you, Jared? You go first. Take the dive.
Oh, man. I really want to come up with something that's super underground and unheard of, so I seem really cool. But honestly, Metallica.
Metallica?
Metallica is what probably the first real, when you hear it and you're like, yeah, this is heavy metal, even though you don't know what heavy metal is, Metallica was it. And it was probably Master of Puppets.
Hell yeah.
When I heard Master of Puppets, that was, I mean, still to this day, that's my favorite, my most consistently favorite heavy metal album. So I gotta say Metallica.
Honestly, that's a good answer. We'll get into it when we get into mainstream metal and all that jazz. But man, do I have a love-hate relationship with Metallica. And I saw them at BlizzCon 2 years ago. You know what I mean? So
what the fuck were they doing at BlizzCon?
Dude, last year was Linkin Park. I don't even know,
oh,
man.
Good lord. Oh, so it was way better last year is what you're trying to say.
the live show, I mean, we'll get into it. Nico, what about you?
Well, believe it or not, my first exposure is Metallica.
Oh my God.
I remember anytime we went somewhere back in my youth, my dad always had the Black Album in the car, like in the CD player. And I've listened to that probably the most in my life for, I guess, not really, I don't want to say any band, but definitely Metallica, the Black Album, I've heard a whole lot. I pretty much grew up with that and I just loved it. Man.
I mean, I really shouldn't be surprised. Even though I'm going to try to hold my ammo, even though I hate the modern Metallica shit, like, I have to admit, like, old Metallica's fucking breathtaking. Ride the Lightning, Master of Puppets, Justice for All, like, it's good shit. But what about you, Wes?
It's going to have to be Guns N' Roses' Appetite for Destruction.
Ooh, there's an answer.
Yeah, dude. A friend of mine, like, I had just moved, so I had to make new friends. And the friend that I ended up making friends with, his dad was a big metalhead, so he introduced me to a lot of stuff. But what really stuck with me was that album, Guns N' Roses, Appetite for Destruction. And, man, listen to that all the time back in 1988, man. Just, whew. So that's what did it for me. But it was actually Metallica, Ride the Lightning, that got me into the heavier stuff.
I like the universal answer of Metallica. That's not what I was expecting, but I can't honestly say I'm too surprised.
They're a gateway band, man.
They are. I think it's the one thing that unites, because you were talking about there's all these different genres and different ideas of what heavy metal is, but in between all of us, it's always Metallica is the unwritten rule. It's like you meet somebody, hey, what kind of music you listen to? Metallica, they know already coming out. You don't have to say that. Just come up with the second band you were thinking of, you know?
Yeah.
That's great, man. See, for me, and just a slight trigger warning as we get into this, just because I'm sure at some point it's going to happen. Metal is a genre that is more of an umbrella term nowadays. Like, there are so many subgenres, and there are some bands people consider metal that some people don't. So if at any point you hear a band that you're like, oh, what the fuck, I'm furious about this, just fucking get over it. You know what I mean? we're going to talk about it anyways. But for me, and I guess I didn't need that big of a trigger warning for this, but it was always Rush. Rush was a band that just I heard all the time when I was younger, and I don't really know why. I mean, I'm in Colorado. It's not like I'm near the border, you know what I mean? And I didn't exactly know a ton of metalheads. I grew up in a pretty suburban area, you know what I mean? But Rush was one of the first metal bands I think I really got into. It was a little different for me, though, too, because I had a my musical background, I played jazz for 4 years professionally. That was, like, the first gig I ever landed. So I had way more exposure to, like, ska and punk and shit like that than I ever really did metal. You know what I mean? So finally, I'm in high school and I'm getting closer to graduating and stuff like that, and that's when I'm seeing, like, progressive rock and alternative rock and all this weird shit that's, you know, like, what fucking genre do you put it in? Like, Taramellos and shit like that. Like, so, for me, Rush was always, like, a real gold standard for, like, classic metal, you know what I mean? And once again, especially with those older bands, it's hard to say if something is quote-unquote metal or just classic rock, you know what I mean? It's all really hard to say. But, I mean, I guess this is kind of a segue. If we look into, like, the foundations of metal, right? If we look when it all started forming, and this is in the show notes and everything like that, in the 50s to the mid 60s we start seeing prominent what we would now call classic rock bands, which I guess then just call them fucking rock bands, you know what I mean, setting up a lot of foundations for the genre, because that's when we see bands like Rolling Stones and The Who and Deep Purple and Cream. And while they're not necessarily metal bands themselves, like, a lot of the tropes come out of there, a lot of the guitar stylings, you know what I mean? And I think that's why it wasn't necessarily a hard sell to me, because the Rolling Stones is my dad's, like, go-to. Like, that is all he fucking listens to. No joke. Like, it is so much Rolling Stones, it's insane. And I have kind of a hard time with them because, I'll be honest, not really a country guy. I like to think that I have an eclectic taste in music, but with a few exceptions, I can't do country. I don't identify with the message. I don't like the sounds. Like, and I mean,
I can take a little bit of country. There are some artists that are real. I mean, Charlie Daniels Band is always, like, still in Saigon.
Yeah.
It's fucking incredible. There's good some shit. Country.
Johnny Cash, Willie Nelson, like, all that shit. You know,
how do you
not smoke weed and, you know, not like Willie Nelson? That's not the way it fucking works, you know? So, but that some of that Rolling Stone stuff is really fucking Southern to me. But the first accredited metal bands, quote unquote, if you're from the U.S., a lot of people say Led Zeppelin. If you're from the U.K., a lot of people say Black Sabbath. I'll admit that I was always raised to believe it was Black Sabbath.
I think so. Yeah.
And I don't know about you guys, but if we want to get into, like, the late 60s, early 70s bands, this is probably a good place to do it. This isn't the mainstream rock, so this isn't where we're going to be talking shit like Metallica or anything like that. But here we're talking Sabbath, Zeppelin, AC/DC, Blue Oyster Cult, Aerosmith, shit like that.
Yeah. I would say that's about right. Black Sabbath, to me, I think more personified what modern heavy metal is. As far as tone and subject matter, I would say Led Zeppelin. Led Zeppelin, you could make a lot of people back in the day would make the argument that we were taking from blues, because blues was this huge music style from African Americans that just, I don't know, it seemed like every other music style that we listened to, a lot of our country and bluegrass came from blues, you know what I mean? So you could see that argument more with Led Zeppelin than you could with Black Sabbath. Black Sabbath was heavy metal. If you listen to it right now, it sounds like heavy metal today. I mean, a little different. But I would say Black Sabbath more personifies what we listen to right now as heavy metal.
I agree with that for sure. Just the distortion they used, the dark subject matter.
Yeah.
I mean, Black Dog is one of my absolute favorite Zeppelin tracks, and, like,
that's probably my favorite one.
It's heavy as shit, dude. Like, that guitar line fucking rips. I don't know. I love Zeppelin. Once again, it can't necessarily call them quote unquote metal, and I'm sure there are more than a few bands we'll talk about. But that fucking sound, I really like that classic, like, rock classic metal sound, you know what I mean? Like, especially Sabbath. Oh, my God. And it's funny how when you listen to it now, and I was listening to a bunch of this shit doing the research, too, and it really does sound so bluesy. Like, there's a lot of it in it, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, I think why Black Sabbath blew up the way they did is because a lot of the hard rock bands back then, from what would evolve into heavy metal, like you said, they have this blues sound. Black Sabbath had this low tone to it, where everybody else was going for a higher tuned guitar sound throughout the entire song. Black Sabbath was going for a very low, chunky sound, which just nobody had done at that point. And it sounded darker because of it. You know what I mean? It just sounded more ominous and nasty. Whereas a lot of the hard rock had that bluesy kind of, the way they would dance on notes would be a lot of the higher notes, and they would follow those for more of a rhythmic kind of thing. Where Black Sabbath's just a crunching kind of just slamming sound, you know?
I mean, that you can also blame that sort of on where they came from, just because they formed in the industrial areas. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
just like,
exactly.
Hey, we're all fucking steel factory workers. I lost a fucking finger. Let's make a band, and it's just gonna fucking grind. Like,
yeah, and you could hear it for sure.
It's funny too, because like I'm looking at the list of prominent metal bands from that time period, and I will give credit to the musicians. But I have a very difficult time enjoying Aerosmith. I don't know if any of you guys have that problem.
I enjoy Toys in the Attic, but that's about it.
No, you know what? The album 9 Lives, I actually really liked. There's some good songs on that album. I never got into 70s Aerosmith, though, just because, you know, I was born in 85, so they had that heroin, you know, ship had sailed a long time after I was born. So when I got into Aerosmith, it was more around the time that 9 Lives came out, because a lot of their music videos were hitting MTV again. This was like the reemergence of Aerosmith. And I get onto that album, but, you know, I wouldn't call myself like an Aerosmith fan, but there's like 6 solid tracks off of 9 Lives. That's really good.
It's one of those sounds that I just have such a hard time buying into. Like, and I can't necessarily say why I don't like it. Like, I can't pinpoint my finger on it, you know what I mean? Because talented musicians, Steven Tyler's fucking hilarious. Great dude. Like, I'm super into that, you know what I mean? But like, I don't know. I just can't get into it. But Judas Priest, man, there's a fucking sound. Oh my God. You just think of leather and studs, you know what I mean? Like, that's the fucking cell.
Yeah, I'm of two minds on Judas Priest. I like early Priest with the real high power metal vocals. I didn't like a lot of Breaking the Law Priest with just low talking like this. Mm-hmm, I wasn't a huge Hellbent for Leather was a good song where he had that vocal style, but I like your more you know, your high-pitched, like, power metal kind of vocals from them.
I agree with that, too.
It's true.
I love Rob Halford's voice. Very distinct and recognizable.
Yeah, sure.
Also, AC/DC. I guess I didn't really think about this until you mentioned the fact that you were really, you know, listening to music in 85, all that, you know, being born, all that shit, right? But I was born in the 90s. Like, I was born in 1990, you know what I mean? So by the time I was listening to music, it had all been washed out by grunge. You know what I mean? So it took me such a long time to get exposed to these bands. But AC/DC, man, fucking Thunderstruck. I know this is going to be a really funny story, but Command & Conquer Generals. I used to land that game all the time with my friends. And the playlist was just like Led Zeppelin, AC/DC. Like, I don't know what it was, man. It's just, even now, just thinking about it, just some of those fucking guitar riffs.
No, they were heavy as fuck, that's for sure.
But the real bulk of this, and I'm sure what most of us want to talk about, is mainstream metal, which is late 70s to early 80s. That's where we see Motorhead, fucking Iron Maiden, Death Leopard, shit like that. Who wants to get into it?
Man, I could get into that. And I'll tell you, I'm going to get into it by expressing a very unpopular opinion. I don't like a lot of the progenitor metal bands.
I'm with you on that too, dude.
a lot of that said, you know, this is, I explained it the same way I explained Star Wars. Is I got into sci-fi movies that were inspired by Star Wars that were way better, because, you know, they're building off of the building blocks that, you know, these movies have made. And it's the same thing with heavy metal. I can go back and I can appreciate maybe some Sabbath or something like that, but I don't really listen to a lot of classic metal. Like, I won't go back and just, like, get down on some AC/DC or anything like that. But I think when you're starting to enter the 80s is when I start to hear a little more heavy metal hit. You know, you went from, like you were talking about, you went from blues and then Black Sabbath took it this real dark, nasty area. And then in the 80s, you start to break out with the power metal sound. Mm-hmm. So a lot of metal in the 80s, it was very classical in composition. You can hear literally like classical like song structure as far as guitar notes and stuff, and then you had the high vocals. So I think that's when I actually start really getting down and listening to heavy metal is around the late 70s, early 80s.
I just think 80s is a time period for metal is a really, really funny period of time. Because 81 is when MTV launches, right? Boom, all of a sudden we have music videos on TV. And then that's when we're still seeing, you know, like heavy metal. We're still seeing Iron Maiden, shit like that. But then all of a sudden we're getting hair metal and arena rock and shit like that. For the record, it's a weakness. Everybody has those guilty pleasures. Absolutely love Twisted Sister. I know it's horrible, but talking about arena rock and shit like that, I fucking love Dee Snider.
Nah, Twisted Sister's not that bad, really.
Yeah,
Dee Snider's a smart guy.
Yeah. Cool motherfucker, too.
Yeah.
It's true.
80s was a good time for metal because you had a lot of really popular, what you could call, like, you know, the beginnings of heavy metal bands before the 80s. But in the 80s is when heavy metal got really put into the mainstream. Your normal, you know, high school kid who doesn't listen to heavy metal was watching heavy metal videos because they were on MTV, you know?
Yeah.
Everybody was exposed in the 80s, I think.
Well, I mean, that was really like the reign, right? I mean, that's all the big tours, all the big names, all the big albums, you know what I mean? Yeah. Shit, Megadeth, Slayer, Pantera, which also, for the record, and I've been saying this for years, if I were ever to kill a motherfucker, like straight up commit criminal murder in like the first degree, not that I'm planning on it, but it would be to walk by Pantera. I swear to God, like I cannot think of a better song to fucking do it to.
Man, I don't know. I think that song is so overrated, man.
It is. It can be for sure. It's super heavy. That's how I learned how to, when I started learning how to play the drums, was just playing to that song because of how simple it was. But it's super heavy. Pantera, this is another unpopular opinion. Anything past Cowboys from Hell, I'm not huge on with Pantera. I like I like the more interesting song structures. They took out the chunkiness and they were more like, they're a little faster, a little more unique to me. Back when I don't know, Cowboys from Hell came out, that was what did it for me. And then I heard the later stuff like Walk and Cemetery Gates, and I'm like, yeah, this stuff is good. There's a lot of hits on these albums, but if we're talking about like interesting music.
What about the pre-Cowboys from Hell stuff?
Nah, I didn't like any of that.
Really?
Like,
because it sounds a lot like Cowboys to Hell.
That's why I like Cowboys from Hell, is that medium between your vulgar display,
and
pre-Cowboys from Hell. Right there in the middle, I like that uniqueness, and then the heaviness is still there. Yeah.
Honestly, I think that's one thing I like about metal generally, and not to cut you off, and you can continue after I say this real quick, but as a genre, I feel like it's really creative, and I think that might be why there's so many sub-genres, is like there's so many bands that you hear them and you're just like, holy shit. I mean, once again, stretching the term metal here, but like the first time I heard Dream Theater, like the first time I actually sat down and listened to like Octavarium or like Animals as Leaders, shit like that. It was just like, whoa, and I know that's a whole different time period, but I'm just saying, like, as a genre, I think you can kind of say that metal's never really been scared of being progressive.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, think about it, and bringing it back to the 80s, you were talking about how crazy of a time the 80s was. You had, like, Quiet Riot sharing, you know, screen time with Slayer, like you were talking about, and the progenitor of Cannibal Corpse was going on at the same time that, like, arena rock love ballads were out. Like, that was an insane time. And even back then, metal was this giant genre, and they all fit into it. It's interesting.
Well, it's just so funny, too, because there are a lot of people I know who if you're like, oh man, I can get down on some poison and shit like that, they're like, oh, what'd you fucking say? Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's so weird. Like, and maybe this is also, once again, just the area that I'm in, but it seems like if you're talking about metal and you're not talking about, like, heavy fucking shit or, like, deathcore, people are like, oh, you're just a pussy, dude. Like, yeah. I don't know if I agree with that.
I think that's a younger attitude.
I don't know. I like my heavy shit, man.
I do.
I get bored with the lighter stuff, man. If it's not very fast, it really depends. But yeah. I like heavy. I like it fast. I like it aggressive. But that's also because I have a huge hardcore background. So.
Oh, there you go. See, I like a lot of. And keep in mind, in my time period, you know, when I'm in high school and shit. Stuff that's considered hardcore is mainly like screamo and speed, you know, speed metal and shit like that. So it was never a genre that was wildly appealing to me. You know what I mean? It like people were like, oh man, have you heard Job for a Cowboy? And I'm like, oh god, what the fuck is this shit? Like, I don't know, man. I had a hard time getting into it. I really didn't.
I don't like. Yeah, don't
man,
like
you had a rough time, man. Your generation is. It's a little rough as far as hardcore goes. That's true, though. Like, what you're saying is true, because when at around that time, that's what hardcore was. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But, like, when I came up, 10-Yard Fight was hardcore. Like, when I first heard hardcore, that's what I thought punk rock was. When I first heard Minor Threat, the speed and the anger, so I was like, mm-hmm. All right, I'm into punk rock, so I'm down with that. And then somebody showed me Rancid, and I was like, oh, okay, so this is garbage, and it's not punk. Fuck you. You know what I mean? Because... I went from, because what I thought was punk rock at the time, I didn't know there was hardcore punk rock. So when I heard Teen Idols and Minor Threat, that's what I thought punk rock was. And then I hear this soft, clean vocals with acoustic guitars. Get the fuck out of here with that. That's not punk. You know, but that ended up being what hardcore was to me, whereas that's crazy. You're going through school and somebody's like, yeah, My Chemical Romance has like this hardcore song.
Yeah, dude, don't even get me into that shit. Like, yeah, have you heard Bullet for My Valentine? Are you into that shit?
Oh my God. It was a rough time. I mean, I lived through it, so I feel your pain. I was there. People were dyeing their hair black. We've all
been there. I was fucking submerged in it, though, dude. You know what I mean? And so, like, I don't know, maybe it was just me. I guess this might apply to Nico and, like, how you were exposed to music. But, like, if there's ever a genre I wanted to explore, and like I said, there was a period of time where I really got into punk. And especially, like, Wave 3 American punk. Like, I fucking love Bad Religion. Don't get me started on that shit, you know what I mean? But, like, if I ever wanted to listen to music, I had to dig for it, man. Because everything in my area, just nobody listened to shit, dude.
And this was before, really and truly... At least when I started getting into punk rock, how you had to get into albums that were underground was you had to go on fucking like LimeWire or Kazaa or Napster.
Oh,
and
God.
Shit.
And just give your computer cancer just to find like the latest whatever punk rock album no one's ever heard of before. So it was hard finding, you know, music back then, defining your own genres because you couldn't find it.
Yeah, and I had to find it going to fucking when we'd go to burnouts, we were hanging out with high school kids, you know, buying drugs and shit, and they're playing DRI in the background, man. That's how I'm finding the Exploited and shit. That's how I'm finding out about this shit, man. These guys that are way too old to be hanging out with fucking high school kids. You know, smoking weed and dropping acid with them.
Hell yeah, man. That sounds like internet. That sounds like how I found Primus. It was just smoking weed and dropping acid. That's how Primus came into my life, was that period of time.
But, I can see how that could make Primus's music very good.
Yeah.
I
can see that. Very exciting, Primus, to say the least. Acid, but yeah, like, I don't know, man. I love arena rock. I love hair metal. All that good shit stuff. Is guilty pleasures, man. It's just...
Yeah.
I don't know.
I mean, even Motley Crue had some, like... You could... I mean, hell like, yeah. Motley Crue... You couldn't say, like, oh, every song they made was heavy metal. They made a lot of arena rock songs, but, like, LimeWire, I would say that's heavy metal. That was, like, hair metal to me. Like, actual heavy metal, not just glam, you know?
Yeah, that's some good stuff.
But, yeah, I mean, it's just... Speaking of more bands from that era, too, the first time I ever heard fucking Sweating Bullets... Oh my god, there are just so many good bands from that era. It's a good time, but it sounds like, from unless I'm mistaken, The 90s and early 2000s is where people really want to talk about the, like, Marilyn Manson shit.
90s was a weird time. I would say 90s was my stomping ground. That's when heavy metal kind of came into its own for me.
Well, see, I would say. And not to name drop and bring up, you know, the feeling of the time, but I grew up in the Columbine area. Or, like, you know, I grew up in Colorado in that time, right? So I'm in fucking elementary school. Like, I remember fourth grade when that shit happened. You know, I remember that lockdown. And then just being that young and hearing people being like, metal's the devil. Metal's what gets you to shoot people. Marilyn Manson's the fucking Antichrist. And then...
They weren't wrong.
I never got to hear the music. You know what I mean? Like, Nine Inch Nails, Tool, shit like that. Like, I literally did not hear any Tool until I was in high school. Shit you not, period.
Yeah, 90s was a weird time for music, man. It's because this is when I started cutting my teeth on actual music, whether it's hip-hop or heavy metal. But I like to think in the 90s there was so much more of a larger variety of different types of music, whereas nowadays there's so much genre bending that I think every song has a dubstep part and every song has, like, reggae vocals backing it. You know what I mean? Like... Mm-hmm. I feel like back then the idea was if someone got popular with something, like Pantera got huge with that southern rock kind of slamming sound, Primus said, all right, let's do a completely experimental, like, weird progressive sound that makes no sense to anybody else. I think everybody was following that trend, like, all right, well, fuck, you know, Metallica got on the thrash metal thing too early, so let's hit, like, maybe black metal, you know what I mean? Everybody was going for that. I don't know. Like, it was just more of an interesting time for music for me, even compared to right now. And there's some good bands out right now. But the 90s was just so unique.
I mean, it's just like a war of culture. Because at that point, like, the rock everyone's listening to is grunge. You know what I mean? Like, people are blasting Nirvana. Everybody's got fucking plaid jackets on and shit. You know what I mean? Like, metal is a lot of eyes, and I'm not saying it's true or that I agree with the statement or looking at the timeline, it's factual. But a lot of people consider metal to be like a dead genre, you know what I mean? So people were having to reinvent. That's why I was getting pushed forward so hard. That's why you see so much hybridization.
Yeah, back then it was.
Yeah.
See, this is another thing where I completely disagree, and this is what pisses me off, is everybody credits, like, oh, Nirvana, oh, they brought back metal to the main. No, they did not. Heavy metal was...
Yeah, they killed it.
Yeah. Heavy metal was... I mean, they were... It was amazing back then, but Nirvana got on MTV because Smells Like Teen Spirit. It was a shitty music video, and everybody was in love with it. But there were bands out there that were not only doing well, but playing great music and getting airtime. It was just Nirvana blew up the way, you know, like, I don't know, an internet famous person just overnight, like, oh, you know. I don't know. I don't like Nirvana. Some grunge is good. Nirvana did not bring metal back from the dead. Metal was alive and kicking. Guns N' Roses were around at the same time Nirvana was, and they were still playing good music even then. Mm-hmm. This was before they started sucking ass. So I don't credit Nirvana with a reinvigorating of metal. Like,
oh,
a lot
good.
Of people
God,
do.
No. I think anybody who says that doesn't understand exactly what grunge did to metal, because it was pretty ruthless. It swallowed it whole. Like, it just
it was an
off.
Interesting idea at first. It was a cool idea, and had... Only your grunge is a weird word, because you could say, all right, Nirvana was grunge, but then so was Pearl Jam and Soundgarden, and neither of
those
three
bands
sound
the same.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, it's because they were from Seattle.
Yeah. It was just an umbrella term that didn't mean anything. Nirvana was the band that everybody gave the attention to when there was bands playing better music, making more money. They just weren't in the public eye like Nirvana was, and Kurt Cobain couldn't handle that. I think if they would have actually put their time in and developed a sound like a lot of other bands had, maybe, you know, Kurt wouldn't have blew his damn brains out.
Oh my God.
That guy was such a wiener. God, fuck.
I don't
so deep and interesting. Fuck you, Kurt Cobain. Holy shit.
That is an entirely different discussion we can get into. Well, no, I'm just laughing so hard because you have to realize that one of my dear, close, personal friends is a avid believer that Courtney Love is the one who killed Kurt Cobain. That it wasn't a suicide and tinfoil hat and all this theory. And, like, I just... whenever anybody talks about the Kurt Cobain paint job, it's just like, oh man, I don't even want to touch that with a 10-foot fucking pole. Yeah.
Either way, it's the end result that's important. Whoever.
Oh my god, you're gonna get banned from Facebook again.
Oh fuck.
It's funny though, now that it's getting mentioned in chat, and I know we were talking about this a little bit before the show started, but anybody want to cut into nu metal? Anybody want to slice into that lump of beautiful?
Yeah. I mean,
Jesus, I mean,
well, all right, here's my thing with nu metal, and it really annoys me, is like when nu metal started getting popular, and I guess it's got popular pretty much with Korn. I mean, that's the first band I guess that would be considered nu metal, and even Korn I would say is heavier than most of the nu metal bands that
agreed entirely. For sure.
But what I really didn't like, and the same thing happened with grunge too, is when this music got all popular, then metal started to conform to it. You didn't see leads anymore. That really drove me nuts. Machine Head is a perfect example, where they kind of did like a nu metal album, even had a couple of like rap style songs. And I still like the album. It's still good stuff, but they didn't have leads anymore. They didn't use double bass.
It took them a long time to come back to that sound too. It was like the 2000s, mid 2000s when they brought back, you know, that sound. And even then when they did that, it was more of a metalcore kind of tremolo picked sound than it was their original, just heavy metal. I agree with what you're saying, though. I think nu metal kind of took over, and it became this big, just like grunge, this umbrella term that a lot of people wanted to be under. Like, I don't know, take a band like Chimera. They fall technically under nu metal. That's a heavy metal band. They have solos, and they're heavy and nasty. They don't have
fast.
That. They're fast as hell, yeah. Yeah, nu metal, I think they did a lot for as far as the fame of the genre. But it did kind of pigeonhole a lot of stuff and just stuff things where it shouldn't have been. But there's a, like we were talking about before we even went live, is there's a lot of bands that fall under that term that don't deserve to be called nu metal. Like we were talking about Rammstein. A lot of people, that's what they see as nu metal. They see a dude rocking a Rammstein shirt. They're like, oh, look at this nu metal guy over there.
Yeah.
And Rammstein's amazing. They don't sound like anything I would consider nu metal, which is, you know, your Korn kind of, you know, sound. Nu metal is interesting. There's some really good bands that came out of it. And why nu metal is interesting, I think, is because after nu metal kind of like dropped in popularity in your early 2000s, and for me here in Florida, at least, the hardcore scene shot up in popularity. So the real big thing for the longest time in the hardcore scene was, fuck these nu metal kids. I hate these small goth nerds.
Yeah.
And that developed in, because you would be at a show when you were trying to swing into the crowd and, you know, people are trying to push mosh with you. So you took that hatred for small goths and you applied that also to the music they listened to, when there was some heavy shit out there that you were just kind of like, a lot of people were ignorant about. And, you know, that was a shitty time. But nu metal was interesting. There's some good stuff going on then. That it took me a long time to start listening to and be like, ah, I need to have an open mind.
See, the problem for a lot of nu metal with me isn't that I, like, implicitly think a lot of it is terrible, even though I do, because I cannot stand Fred Durst, and he's just, like, the face of nu metal to my generation, you know what I mean? But a lot of the new or groups that are credited as quote-unquote nu metal, right, are really, really hit and miss for me. Like, I was just surprised when I looked it up and saw that Disturbed and Slipknot were considered nu metal, quote unquote. Because those are both bands that have some tracks that I really enjoy, but generally it doesn't click with me. I don't know what it is, especially Slipknot. I love Joey Jordison. Joey Jordison is an insanely talented musician. Really love the Murder Dolls too. But I've always had such a hard time listening to Slipknot. I can't fucking do it. I don't know what it is. I think it's the guy playing a keg. Maybe.
I don't know.
They've got some heavy stuff. I went through a solid period. I heard their first album, the self-titled album, songs like Spit It Out, where it's like, whoa, these guys are killing it.
That's an awesome song. Yeah.
And I went through a period. I had a demo CD back from the day from like Hot Topic, one of the Metal for the Masses albums, and it had a demo of Spit It Out. There was a little faster, a little more nasty recording, and it sounded great, and that's what got me into Slipknot. And then I went through a period, like, all the new metal kids were listening to Slipknot, and I was just like, I can't do this. There's people in my high school wearing jumpsuits to school.
Yeah, you know
what,
dude.
I mean? What? Really?
Jesus. I had to drop it for a little bit. I had to drop Slipknot. Disturbed, I never got into. I wasn't big on the vocals, and the lead singer just seems to have a huge head. Like, he thinks he's the best dude in the world.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Plus, you can't watch an interview with that guy, because he's got his two things. Every time he says a word, it's like, tick-tick-tick-tick-tick-tick-tick-tick-tick-tick.
Oh, shit.
I can't focus on what he's saying. Tests. Yeah, I never got into Disturbed, but I would say Disturbed 100% is when I think of nu metal. Disturbed comes to mind before Limp Bizkit.
Really?
I think Cold Chamber.
I love Cold Chamber.
I'm not saying that thing. Yeah. I didn't like it at first, but I hung out with a kid 10 years younger than me that I met at work, and he really liked Cold Chamber, and I gave it a shot, and I was digging on it.
Yeah. They're a guilty pleasure. I could see why people wouldn't like Cold Chamber. I could see why people might like... what was his band after that?
Devil Driver?
Devil Driver is more of a heavy metal sound.
Devil Driver, yeah.
Devil Driver's good. Cold Chamber just personified to me that nasty, aggressive sound that I kind of associate with nu metal. It has a more rhythmic beat to it, and it just sounds angry. And then you had really weird parts, especially with vocals. There's a lot of weird parts where someone would be screaming with a real loud, deep voice, and out of nowhere, you'd be like, "Oh, I'm so sad," you know, they break into something like that. That's what personifies nu metal to me. It's just weird oddness like that. You'd be super heavy, and then like you'd have fucking what's his name, John from Korn.
Jonathan Davis.
You could have looked at me while you were raping me.
Bringing back the kill.
That is what I think of when I think of nu metal is that combination of just odd. It's almost like you really wanted to look like you had a mental instability issue on stage. Like you just wanted to like hunch over and just like.
Yeah,
that was nu metal to me.
I could see that. I guess it's a little. And once again, this might just be an area thing. I do have a little bit of fondness for Korn. I'm not going to say they're a wildly good band. I'm not going to say, you know, their entire anthology is fantastic. But, like, Follow the Leader's fucking amazing album. Like,
I think that one's kind of weak.
Follow the Leader only had, like, two good songs on it for me.
I was thinking a different album. No. Yeah, Follow the Leader was... Yeah, it only had a handful of good songs on it.
Life is Peachy and Korn are two of the heaviest albums. They are just fucking heavy. There's
is brutal.
Take a Look in the Mirror is a really good album. I got that for Christmas, too. I don't think my mom knew what she got me.
Hardcore bands nowadays that are going for that Korn sound because their riffs were to what hardcore became and what Korn was... Those kind of like slow, chunky breakdowns, they were in Korn and full effect. So a lot of bands like Warhound right now, their new album is just old Korn, and it's amazing.
Okay, here's another funny story too, and another reason why I probably have a slight fondness for Korn. Another thing that got me into the genre is like eighth grade year, freshman year of high school, right? All of the, I guess I don't want to use the term slutty women, but all of the really... Not
the women of ill repute.
It's the not prudes that were in the area were all like, you know, mall goths. Hey, let's listen to fucking metal and find somebody to buy us packs of cigarettes. So I was like, shit, I need to start dressing in black and listening to this fucking music. Apparently, like,
yeah, goth girls got down on some wieners. That's for sure.
There's the Appalachian Jared quote of the year. Oh my god!
Everybody loves goth girls. They're great.
Yeah, it's funny. I really feel like we could just sit here and keep bashing on nu metal. Like, once again, a band that maybe three or four songs I like, but Linkin Park, and it didn't even really hit me. It didn't even hit me until I saw them at BlizzCon. I was like, man, this is a really good live show, but the music's fucking horrible. Like, and it was funny, because I'm looking around, and they're literally just sections of people just sitting. Just like, is the closing ceremony finished yet? Can we leave? Like, oh my god. So much of that is terrible. Papa Roach. Oh my god. Yep. So much of it is just
Papa Roach. There you go, summarized there.
Oh.
I have a guilty pleasure with Linkin Park, man. That first album, Hybrid Theory. I hate to sound like such a dork, but there was actually a breakup that album got me through. I don't know what it was. Something about see, in Miami we had this this TV service. What was it called? The Box is what it was called, and it would show one music video, and then in the bottom corner they would show two other music videos, and you would call in and vote for the one you wanted next. And I saw this one of these dudes rocking out and headbanging. I was like, oh, cool, like a heavy metal video. Called in, voted for it. Linkin Park's oh Christ, what's that song where he goes, "Shut up when I'm talking to you," or something like, "Shut up when you're talking to me." Oh Christ, I forget what the song's called.
I know what you're talking about. I don't know the name.
It was their first big hit, and I saw that music video, and I was like, "This, whoa, all right, I'm going to the record store. This album's got to be bought." Listened to it all the way through. Broke up with my girlfriend. Took lyrics from this album. Now, at this time, Linkin Park was getting no play, right? Nobody gave a shit about Linkin Park. So I took the lyrics to one of the sad songs that was kind of like sort of geared towards my situation and wrote a letter to my ex-girlfriend, like this soppy bullshit letter of Linkin Park lyrics, and then said it was mine. Like, I admit.
Classic.
And
I bleed it out.
Wouldn't you know, that song blew up.
Baby, I wrote it. Baby, it was me.
I could have swore. I honestly think it was the lyrics to that "Crawling in My Skin" song.
Yeah, it might be that one.
Oh my God, that's why I have a connection to Linkin Park nowadays, is because you can't live down that kind of experience.
Well, see, it's funny because I will admit I liked Rising Ted as a project more than I liked Linkin Park, just for the record. But I feel like that genre, generally speaking, is one of those things where I look back at that period in my life, and it's just like, what the fuck was everyone thinking? What happened here? Like,
well, you know,
it's not a coincidence. Most of those bands aren't around anymore.
Except for Linkin Park, they're making a shit ton of money still. They put like techno parts in their song, and fucking people are eating it up. It's insane.
You got to adapt to survive. Yeah. Nico, you're just upset. What the fuck?
I regret, because I listened to the Meteor whatever fucking album in middle school, because middle school was the shittiest part of my life, and this, I was like, oh, this album, it's perfect for me. I'm all alone. I was just listening to this, and now I'm looking back like, God damn it, why did I listen to that album? Why can't I have something a little better at least? I fucking breaking the habit. Fucking, ugh, God damn it. That was like my song. I was
to
like,
be fair, though, that is a really good music video. That is a beautifully animated
Music
video.
Yeah, this video's good, but it's just...
That's like the animated song, one, right?
Yeah, it's the animated one where the guy kills does suicide in reverse or whatever the fuck.
Yeah,
that was the only one that at BlizzCon anybody really got up and moved to.
Talk about a 2000s nu metal band name, Suicide in Reverse. If we had a time machine, Donovan.
Could just fucking print money, man.
Oh, shit, that could have sold so well.
It's just one of those things where it's like, I understand that music is alive. It's not a static thing. Music changes, it reflects the culture. But it's one of those things where when I think of like the 90s and early 2000s, like what the fuck was it? Like seriously, like okay, like the set, like 60s, you get a clear fucking picture. 70s, you get a clear fucking picture. 80s, everyone's fucking wearing neon and fucking all that shit, mm-hmm. right? 90s, you can like kind of say was like a grunge era, like grunge underground hip hop. Like, but like, what the
first half of the 90s, then the second half kind of moved away from that. It's
just like great pace. Like, what the fuck was the late 90s and early 2000s? Seriously.
Now I can say that for mainstream, it wasn't the best time, especially because nu metal, that's when it came into its own, was your late 90s. But I would say late 90s was the best time for underground heavy metal, because bands like Cannibal Corpse were getting a foothold and just destroying the music scene. Death metal was killing it in the 90s. Deicide was absolutely amazing. I think underground music...
I want to hear Wes talk. Let's hear these groans, because I actually like Cannibal Corpse.
Alright, Deicide in the late 90s, they released Incinerate Him. That was like their slow album, which I feel kind of conformed to more of the new metal stuff. Really? Slayer did Diabolus in Musica. That was kind of a new metal-y sounding thing. There was Soulfly. They were totally.
Actually, I like Soulfly a lot. I'm not gonna lie. I like
Soulfly too. Fear Factory's obsolete. They were using stand up bass in it and stuff, you know, to get that lower sound. And while those are all great albums and I love them all, they were going in that direction. I like the more thrashier stuff. But
yeah, so a lot of that thrashier stuff you just weren't getting in the late 90s, though. Exactly. Just nobody was doing it.
That's what I was fiending for.
I can see where you're coming from there. I think the late 90s is what brought us Cannibal Corpse Bloodthirst, which is probably one of the best death metal albums ever recorded, period. And it, to me, that had that fast sound that you were looking for, but those slow, heavy parts that I liked.
Yeah.
It's a crowd pleaser, man. That's probably one of the greatest death metal albums anybody's ever even listened to before. And the late 90s brought that about because the underground was breeding a lot of this stuff. Man, that was a killer time. Oh, what? Cannibal Corpse in the 90s. What I would give to see that.
I don't know, man. I'll take The Bleeding any day.
Really? You're one of those. You're
Bleeding's my favorite. I think The Bleeding might be the best death metal album ever.
I could see that. I had Corpse Grinder, Cannibal Corpse, thrown on me first. That's when I first started hearing it.
Yeah,
the Chris Barnes stuff is killer. Seeing Through the Eyes of the Dead, insanity. Whoa, it's absolutely amazing. But I can see where you're coming from because that was when they were faster. They had a faster kind of thrashier sound back in The Bleeding. They started adapting blast beats and more of like a nasty kind of heavy tone towards your Corpse Grinder era. You know, I could see that. I liked Chris Barnes better in 6 Feet Under, to be completely honest with you. And then the late 90s, early 2000s is when 6 Feet Under comes out, and they were insane too. Probably the simplest music you could write, but still crazy heavy.
Yeah, total like stoner death metal.
Yeah, that's definitely what they were. Mm.
that should be a fucking genre. That should be printed in, like, when you go by Best Buy and you're looking through the sections, fucking stoner death metal.
there is now a pretty hardcore following for stoner metal and like shit like that.
Cannabis Corpse.
not even Cannabis Corpse, because they're just kind of like a death metal band joking off of that. Tomb of the Resonated, what a good song name. But your actual like slow stoner metal, like the Sword, and who else is playing? Weed Eater, like all these stoner metal bands. And they're just like, it's like a 7-minute song with like four riffs in it, but it's so slow. It's like, rings out for a minute and a half. We're getting off subject here.
Well, not too far, because you mentioned The Sword, and that's in the next era. Like, we can kind of move past slamming on nu metal, though admittingly it is easy and fun, so it's not too hard to do. It's one of those periods where everybody just kind of lost their minds at once, with the exception of a few bands, you know what I mean? But
it's an easy target.
Late 2000s, and in the decade we're in right now, we see reemergence of a lot of really like classic archetypes of metal. We see a lot of melodic metalcore and just general metalcore with like Hatebreed, Killswitch Engage, Earth Crisis, shit like that. A lot of European metal, which I'm super into. Children of Bodom, awesome. Dimmu Borgir, awesome. You know what I mean? Great shit. Death metal with Whitechapel, Suicide Silence, Carnifex, which for the record, I have a slight weakness for Carnifex solely because I'm a Warhammer fag. Like, because I'm just super into Tyranids, like, shit, dude, my internet handles old One Eye, you know what I mean? Like, if it's got Carnifex as the title, I'll buy the CD and listen to it, you know what I mean?
They're super nice guys. I went on tour with them. They're super cool guys. I didn't get into their music that much, but at the time that they came out, they were playing what was hugely popular, and it just wasn't my sound. I came out of the 90s a huge fan of death metal, and came into the 2000s when your deathcore sound started coming, you know, 2005-ish, and you started hearing bands like All Shall Perish, who was putting the pig squeals in there and those death metal riffs. And I was like, okay, I can get on board with this because I like hardcore and I like death metal. And then Carnifex kind of rode that Suicide Silence deathcore train. And man, that was just Job for a Cowboy. Those were not my bands back then. Whitechapel.
No. I just, Job for the Cowboy, and I know that I just said that I did like Carnifex, but I fucking hate Job for a Cowboy, dude. I literally, every single song of theirs I've listened to, I've turned off halfway through. I just can't fucking do it.
their first album, I hated them because they were just rich kids, and they got together with the idea of making a deathcore band as opposed to, like, they wanted to write music. Like, when they got together, they just bought all of their equipment immediately, and they were like, they started listening to deathcore songs, and then they just emulated that. They were scene kids, you know, fags with a shotgun haircut. They were all rich kids, and then they got together to, it was like a, you know, like one of those, oh, Christ. Like one of those, those bands with like a bunch of people from different bands and like a super band. That's what they were trying to be. They were trying to be that for deathcore. Just a bunch of rich kids. I wasn't into them, and they helped pioneer that sound. And it just, I don't know. It was a perversion of death metal for me, and hardcore. There's some good hardcore too, like you said, Hatebreed. I Will Be Heard started blowing up in the 2000s, and that album. Perseverance, fuck, that was a heavy duty album.
Yeah, that was a good stuff. One. They're not I their last like three albums are just disappointing, man. But their first Hatebreed's first three were just out of this world.
Yeah.
And even like other band, like so many hardcore metal bands or whatever was taking that same formula from Hatebreed. But I don't know what happened to Hatebreed, that something happened.
Have you heard their new album? Because no. It's worthless. It's killer.
Really, it's old, dude. The last few,
but it's heavier.
The last few, I was just so disappointed with. I didn't even bother this time.
Now they had like one good song on each album, and it was like okay at best. Their new stuff is heavy, but the reason why Hatebreed was so heavy and so good is because they were all metalheads. You know, yeah. Jamie Josta was a huge Napalm Death and Crowbar fan, and then their guitarist used to go to sleep listening to Cannibal Corpse. So when they played hardcore, it came across as metal because that's what they listened to. And this is when you started to see metalcore start to show up. And you mentioned Killswitch Engage. They put out Alive or Just Breathing in the early 2000s, and that just changed the whole fucking scene, man. Yeah. Whether or not you like Killswitch, that album changed the course of underground heavy metal. Holy shit. They shaped the entire scene off of one album. It was insanity.
See, it's really weird because when we're talking about that time period, we're talking about me, like, in high school, you know what I mean? Like, actually doing shit and starting to form opinions of my own loosely. And the metal that I remember really being popular is shit like Lamb of God, Coheed and Cambria, shit like that, you know what I mean? And for the record, absolutely love both of those bands. Lamb of God, I fucking burned some of those CDs to death in my car, like just driving around blasting that shit.
What was that song called that they first got big? Was it Black Page? Black?
Oh, I'm sure I can.
Lamb of God?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Black. Oh my God. It was like the song that blew up. It had like a breakdown in it. We all shit our pants because they're a metal band. Lamb of God was killing it, and that was their era. They still make music now, but it's not the same. That first album, when they changed their name from Burn the Priest to Lamb of God, like that was another album that was just, they were a metal band, and they were playing at like the New England Hardcore Fest, and people were losing their fucking minds. Like, where are these metalheads have long hair? What are they doing with breakdowns? It's freaking us all out, man.
Yeah, I just brought up some of their stuff, and Ashes of the Wake, I remember my sophomore birthday, my buddy Garrett gave me that album, and it was just, I don't know, man, I got a lot of fond memories of Lamb of God, and Coheed too. Coheed was a band that, for some reason, it seemed like one of those groups that a lot of people talk shit about, but I don't think they ever actually listened to them, and then, like, I just, the first time I heard Coheed, you know what I mean? Like, I love that sound. It feels like really classic metal, you know what I mean? Just like super melodic, lots of high pitched singing. Like I was listening to a bunch of that before.
Their guitarists are classically trained, and they're super talented guitarists. I really like his vocals. I think they don't write songs that really speak to me. So a couple of songs are really really good, and it's their more like technically written songs. But at the time when I was coming up in this early 2000s, you know, era. Coheed and Cambria was more associated with your softer, kind of like, almost like emo, you know what I mean? It was like they were singing about feelings.
You know
what I mean?
Jesus, come on now, we don't need to use swear words here. Watch your fucking mouth. About breaking
I did
a fist
like
bite.
Them at the time, but I will admit that I contributed to a couple of jokes at their expense, Donovan. I'll
and
be
I,
honest.
I can understand it. I'm just saying, like, the older I get and the more I listened to them, and also went to Riot Fest last year, which is something I kind of want to get into because I saw some sick fucking bands there. But Coheed Live is a killer show, man. They fucking rock it out.
I believe that. They're talented musicians. I don't like their music. They do have some good songs, and I can appreciate those, but I can definitely appreciate they're really good musicians.
And I mean, I think that's fair. It definitely is one of those bands that either you like the sound or you're not. And I could see why you wouldn't, too. Like, people who don't like Coheed, it makes sense to me. It's not... Heavy's not the word for it. Like, I would definitely call it metal, but heavy is not the fucking word for it. You know what I mean? So, I can understand it, but I don't know, man. I guess it could just come from the music background. Like I said, there was a long period of time where I was like, oh, I'm going to be a fucking famous musician. I'm going to take music theory and play in a jazz band and all this shit before I stopped hating myself. And, like, anytime I hear music that's actually really well put together, it's always like, damn, dude, it's pretty fucking good. That's why I listen to so much weird meme shit on the internet, too, is there's just stuff that it's like, oh, my God, this guy actually did work. What the fuck? Like,
yeah, I can see that. You know, the early 2000s was a super killer time for music. It's when I first started going on tour with my death metal band. And, you know, I started going around the country. I'd never been to any of these states. You know, I've only lived in like 4 states. So we were going on tour and I was being exposed to these music scenes. And as you know, Florida is a fucking weird place. And it was odd going to places with like a lot of oddball configurations. And I was exposed to a lot of good music then, but it was kind of crazy seeing. Like I said, Killswitch Engage blew metalcore up. Like, metalcore was it at this point. And this was just before All Shall Perish started hitting the scene and that deathcore sound started hitting. And like you were talking about Lamb of God, that same Lamb of God shirt with, like, the weird eagle with the tower.
Yeah, dude, I know that shirt.
I could draw you that shirt from memory because every scene in every state had 3 kids wearing that same Lamb of God shirt, and they were all metalcore kids. You could tell they're like older metalcore kids because their comb over had grown out to actual long metal hair, but you could see the origins of what were bangs at one point. But that was a real crazy time. Metalcore. It was an underground genre, but you were still seeing Killswitch Engage and Christ, what was their name? This is going to kill me now. The lead singer with the really long dread, Shadows Fall. Shadows Fall. Yeah, and they kind of came around to that same. They were playing a more classical metal sound, but they were still in that metalcore genre. They were playing breakdowns, and they were kind of like trying to get to that metalcore audience. And going on tour at that point, I was exposed to a lot of these metalcore bands. And it's probably why I don't have the best opinion of them, is because a lot of these people are showing me this shit, and I'm like, all right, I fucking get it. We're at a death metal show, you know.
Shut the fuck up! You're gonna get punched. Why am I listening to this? Like,
I developed a little bit of a negative opinion, but even then, I still can't. I mean, to this day, if you take Killswitch Engage and listen to their music from Alive or Just Breathing to when they got Howard as a vocalist, and you listen to like the 9 albums they've made, amazing musicians, killer music, a lot of metalheads, especially I'm sure Wes, you can't have a good opinion because you're older dudes don't like Killswitch Engage. That's the way it works. I get
it. I'm not a fan.
Oh, they're so good. They do have singing parts. They are the metalcore sound that people that came before my generation hate, where you stop the heavy part, the fast part, and you break into the melodic, clean vocals part. I know Wes doesn't like that. I can see it.
Wait, whoa. The first time I ever saw that was a night. It was actually the day Kurt Cobain was found dead. I went to the Sepultura show. They were touring for Chaos AD.
Yeah.
And they had Clutch and Fear Factory there. And Fear Factory came out. It was my first pit I'd ever been in, running around in a circle like, this is some fucking badass death metal shit. All of a sudden, he starts singing, dude. Never seen that shit before.
What the hell is going on here?
And it blew me away, man. So, no, I do like the singing stuff, but now it's just, everyone does it now.
I can
Back
see
then, it was like, whoa, what the fuck is this?
Yeah, I could see that. And I don't like a lot of those bands that jumped on that bandwagon. But Killswitch Engage, man, still to this day, they have their original lead singer back. And his voice is so powerful. And
I'm not going to say that their vocals aren't good. It's just... Yeah. In fact, no, I do like the older... or the original vocalist a lot more than Howard, for sure.
Yeah, I could see that. Yeah, they were good stuff. And this was around the same time that I had just recently... You bring up Sepultura. I was on the street team for Sepultura after they lost Max, and they had that... What was that lead singer with the dreadlocks, the black guy? I forget his name. And this was when... Oh, Christ, what was the album called? This is going to kill me. No.
Nation?
Nation. I was promoting for Nation. I got into a lot of their shows when they would come to Florida. I got to see Kitty. And that's when I saw Morbid Angel. And that's when I was like, all right, death metal. I've liked death metal, but holy shit. Morbid Angel live. I didn't even know what to expect because a lot of the death metal I had heard was not Morbid Angel. And what it sounded like to me is that each member of the band was playing a different song at the same time. And I fucking loved it. Oh, what a good time to be alive. That was weird. I had to literally pass out Sepultura demo CDs and like take pictures and send them into the record label, and they would just mail me free tickets to shows. It was insane.
Hell yeah, dude. That's a good deal.
You could just sign up for it. Nobody knew about it. You could just sign up and then give them your address, and they just send you shit.
And then Dubious wanted had a question for us, and I figured now's a pretty good time to bring it up too. What does everybody think about In Flames? Because apparently that's what got Dubious into metal.
Weird. Really?
Nice fucking older face, Nico, by the way. Good reaction there.
Older In Flames I like better than the newer In Flames, but it's just... It has that European sound to it that I'm just really not that big a fan of.
Not heavy enough for Wes.
No, they're heavy.
I like them.
They're heavy and melodic.
Yeah.
No, I'm just saying that's pretty much been your theme for this whole podcast.
I think what it is that I heard so many European bands that sounded so alike at the time that it just turned me off.
Yeah. I could see that. I like In Flames a lot. In Flames gets a lot of hate in the circles I run in. A lot of people don't like In Flames, and even people who listen to kind of like softer, more melodic metal. But yeah, I love In Flames. Reroute to Remain is a great album. Super good.
And then also, I'm kind of curious because we've all been naming like a bunch of bands that obviously we just fucking love. But Nico, what is like the metal band for Nico? What is the good? Are you just going to say Metallica again?
I mean, here's an interesting thing. I wanted to bring up here when I'm wearing... are the band Budgie, my favorite band of all time. Now, they started out as basically metal, early 70s. They started in the late 60s when they formed. Their first two albums were among the heaviest of their day, as some people like to claim, or as it says on Wikipedia, which you can always trust Wikipedia, right? But really, they had a heavy sound. I showed Wes, well, actually, their albums after their third one, which actually got, like, classic-y and bluesy, and it was a lot more kind of rock and roll and not as, like, metal, as you would describe, but... They still had a sound that was a little bit more, I don't know, definitely going with their first two albums. They're like, you could tell, like, this is heavy. May not classify it as metal, but it's pretty heavy. But by the time in 1980, when they released Power Supply, which is where this guy is from, they're like, I don't know, their mascot or whatever.
Fucking cool. Now, that was some
good metal. Yeah, that's a good shirt, dude.
Yeah, this guy, this is the guy on the album cover of Power Supply. I was about to say Power Metal, but... It kind of felt that way, too, because it got heavy, it was fast, it was really nice. It's a mix. You can be like, oh, no, Budgie's classic rock. If I, like, you know, if you actually sat down and listened to, like, their whole discography, you could be like, okay, yeah, the first two albums were metal and the rest was, like, classic. But, I don't know, I still considered it because they started out that way and they were, you know, they were a big influence to a lot of the then bands coming into the late 70s and, of course, 80s, Metallica, Iron Maiden, Megadeth, all that stuff. They were like the earliest influencers, I would say. But I'm going to say that because I haven't gotten to talk about Budgie, so I will say them, even though may not consider them the metal, but I will, even though for the majority they may not have the metal sound. But I guess, you know, as we talked about, like, what is metal? I mean, there's many genres and different sounds. Well,
it's really hard, especially with that early shit. Like, the line between quote unquote classic rock and metal at times is very fucking thin.
You know what I mean? For sure. Absolutely. It's a weird, like, genre to nail down, because there's so many different kind of sounds in heavy metal that you can't say one. Because a lot of times people like to say, well, that's not metal. But you can't say that anymore, man. Almost everything's metal now. It's insanity. And even back then, the bands that turned into metal, would you say they're not metal? You know, it's just a weird distinction. It's a super broad genre.
I mean, you could argue that Suicidal Tendencies' first album is metal, even though they grew up and hung with all the hardcore, you know, out there in California. And a lot of the punks back then rejected them because they sounded too metal. They had leads.
The
distortion of their guitars. But then Black Flag also, they started getting a little metal-like. In fact, when punk and hardcore started, people started losing interest in it. They just crossed over to metal.
Yeah. Crossover, you know? It was huge back. DRI was a huge crossover band.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they were straight up, just straight ahead hardcore punk rock with some metal influences. And then, boom, you got, like, what, Beneath the Wheel comes out. It's like, whoa, this is heavy metal.
Or their album Crossover, which is just like, hey, this is what we're doing.
Yeah. They knew what they were doing.
Yeah, Corrosion of Conformity is another band that crossed over.
What a weird way to cross over with them. That was a weird band, man.
But if I also want to say, like, something that is kind of proper metal, because, like I said, Budgie may not be cut it, but I probably would say Metallica, because I have listened to all their albums, you know. I actually went forward and then back, you know, Black Album, Load, Reload, Sin Anger, Death Magnetic, and then I went back. Actually, I think it was back before Death Magnetic happened, because then I was like, oh, new Metallica album, it's cool.
That's cool.
I don't care what people say, I like Saint Anger. That was actually my follow-up after the Linkin Park album. I was like, oh, Saint Anger, I like this now.
Okay, I'll admit Saint Anger has some good tracks off of it. Like, there are a couple of songs on it that I can get into, but I just, anything past the Black Album, I can't fucking do, dude. Like, Metallica's the example that I use of, this is what it looks like when a band sells out. It's like Metallica and Kiss. Like, I don't know, man. I have such a hard time. And that's not to talk shit about Metallica, because the old stuff is so fucking good. Master Puppets will break your fucking teeth, you know what I mean? Yeah. But, like, I don't know, man. I have a hard time with new Metallica.
You know, I'd like to know, what is Nico's favorite Metallica album?
Ooh, this has actually been...
No. But I'm just kidding. I really do, because, like I said, after the Linkin Park Meteors, or whatever the fuck that album's called, I was like, okay, a band I'm familiar with, there's Saint Anger. I'll accept this as my middle school, kind of going into high school, like, album, 18 really? Angst thing. Because I say anger, and it was perfect, like, you know, just anger in that album, literally.
No, I get it, dude.
I felt that, because, you know.
Yeah, I mean, when you make a connection to, like, an album like that, that's it for the rest of your life. That's pretty much your album.
And the first two System of a Down albums as well, once again. Oh, yeah. Kind of like, of the time.
Self-titled was amazing. Was it Toxicity after the self-titled album?
Okay, there's a band that I'm surprised we didn't talk about. Where exactly do you classify them?
Because I'm saying new metal. I don't know.
You could say System of a Down. Yeah, System of a Down.
They always were pigeonholed with new metal, but no, dude, no.
Also, another band I saw at that Riot Fest that fucking killed it. Oh my god. But, like, it's such a strange sound. I've always had such a hard time labeling System of a Down.
I could label System of a Down, and it's experimental heavy metal with what I could call Middle Eastern scales.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that makes a lot of sense.
Their scales are very Middle Eastern. You hear a lot of almost like when you start up, like, I don't know, Indiana Jones movie, and he's running through the marketplace, and that's System of a Down if you put really heavy guitars over it, and someone who has like 19 different voices for a lead singer.
He's got a good Serge Takana. Yeah, I liked his voice, and
Serge was he was killer vocalist. He was awesome.
Lakian was.
Yeah, I loved his Fuck the System song. Like, that was a good one from his album. which yes. I would agree. Toxicity is my least favorite of their albums.
I think it's probably my least favorite too, but it's not bad.
Yeah, it's not a bad album.
For of course, me, when you see them live, they play almost the whole fucking album. That's kind of disappointing.
When I saw them at Riot Fest, their set killed. It was a pretty big sampling of shit. And they even ended up doing Cigaro, and I'm like, oh my god, are you fucking kidding me? Sweet. Like, I wasn't expecting that. I didn't know other people liked this song.
Play that one when I saw them.
Yeah.
Man, their self-titled album, for me, is what defined their sound. And everything that came after that, it's hard to explain, but I feel like, and I obviously I have no facts to back this up, but to my ear, Toxicity and Steal This Album sound like they took the parts that were very popular with the self-titled album and tried to write more songs around that, to almost like they were derivative of their own sound. I sound like such a fucking stuck-up asshole.
No, I actually agree with you, dude.
I feel like the songs were less heavy as the albums went on and more weird. You know what I mean? Like, if I had described their albums after self-titled, it was that part of what is it? I think it's the song Toxicity, and there's a lyric where they're just eating seeds as a pastime activity. Yep. Weird and stupid for no reason. That's their music after the self-titled album. No point to weird oddity.
It's so fucking strange.
Mesmerize and Hypnotize are like the weirdest. It's just like
Mesmerize is just out of this world, dude. I think it's brilliant, man. It's just a little bit of everything, and it's fucking fast and heavy, dude. It's awesome, man. That album always gets me moving, gets my head banging, dude. There's so much energy in it. It's great.
That
was a weird band. They were cool.
Yeah. That was my growing up band. But I guess I need to get back quickly to Wes on my favorite Metallica album, because he started and then I mentioned
System. Yeah, sorry. We all got distracted, but I mean, you can blame me for that. I just heard System of a Down and was like, oh shit, I fuck it.
That's really wanted to actually mention or get them talked about, because that was a band I
lots of love
grew up
for
listening
it.
To as well.
Yeah.
But it's hard with Metallica, because when Death Magnetic came out, I was like, this is awesome, because you know, after Saint Anger, pretty much anybody was like, they could do, just go back to their roots, which what they said they were going to do, and they kind of did.
Well, yeah. One thing I can say about Death Magnetic is they did get rid of the trash can lid that they were using for a snare. So that's good on Lars. It's good not to hear a song that you can, the snare was tuned higher than you could actually hear James Hetfield's vocals for a lot of times, so that was interesting.
I know, I kind of like that. Just Saint Anger is weird. I guess just because of me and my teenness, I was just like, oh, I like this album, but I don't know. Soft spot a little bit, but...
So is it
Death Magnetic? Are you saying that's your favorite?
Saint Anger.
There's a lot of good songs.
If you say Saint Anger, I'm going to be a little sad, because like I said, there are a couple good tracks off of it, but... It is no Injustice for All. That is for damn sure.
Well, what's everyone's favorite Metallica album?
I mentioned
this is the conversation that right now is tearing my group chat apart on Facebook.
I mentioned
everybody has a different answer.
It's true. Rewind Mike brought it up in the chat, but Injustice for All, man, and just oh my god, that album,
good album,
fucking great album. Rule for it, man.
It's no Master of Puppets, which is their greatest album.
See, and I'm going to go with Ride the Lightning.
Hey!
Everybody has a different answer. There is as many best Metallica albums as there are Metallica albums at this point.
It's a tie between Death Magnetic and Ride the Lightning. If there was like both category, old and new, I would say new is...
I've never heard anybody say that. It's a tie between those. I've never heard that opinion.
Those are very different albums.
I'll probably go with Death Magnetic to be a little different, because also, I mean, like I said, I didn't born in 1993, didn't grow up with, the early Metallica. So when Death Magnetic was coming out, I was like, I'm hyped, I'm ready for this, you know? So
I'm going to be in the middle. I'm very moderate with Metallica. I'm a moderate Metallica fan. A lot of people say, like, oh, Load, they start selling out, they all cut their hair. I say Reload and Back is their best album experience. Everybody hates on Reload and Load. There's some good songs on Reload.
Oh, yeah.
There was some killer stuff on there. It wasn't thrash metal ballad metal Metallica that a lot of people were used to up to that point. There's some heavy and really well-written songs on those albums, though. It's good stuff, especially Reload. That was a cool album.
I don't know. Metallica strikes me as one of those bands that is really polarizing. It seems like you either love them or you hate them. Or you're like me and it's half and half right down the middle and the line is on the Black Album. That's where the
end a lot of people is. Share that same opinion.
Yeah, that's pretty much where I'm at, yeah.
See, I had loved Metallica, but I didn't develop like a fanboy. I had absolutely adored Metallica at the point when Load and Reload started coming out, and I was hearing the opinions of people. This is when MTV2 was big, and they had this interview with this guy, and he was like, he was talking about Metallica, and he said something like, "Friends don't let friends get friendly haircuts," or something like that. I was exposed to those opinions, but I came into it as kind of like, I already like Metallica, and if this is something new, then I'll listen to it as not Metallica. So I take Load and Reload as really just good kind of like heavy metal albums, not so much like the continuation of Metallica's legacy of thrash metal, you know? So I'm a little lighter, not as mean to the later Metallica stuff as a lot of people are, but I cannot listen to Saint Anger. I can't do it. I've tried.
That's fair.
Do it.
Well, because unless I'm mistaken, and Lord knows that that is a definitive possibility, but Of Wolf and Man is off of Saint Anger, right?
No,
that's the Black Album.
Is that Black Album? Okay, so yeah, that's just the drugs talking. Never mind. Okay, yeah. Black Album it's is always... Black Album's the line for me. That's the end of any good Metallica for me is the Black Album.
You know what I heard? I bought an album once. It was called The Blackest Album, and it was an industrial tribute to the Black Album. It's pretty cool. I just want to put that out there. I remember that.
That's so cool.
Literally from my high school, I saw that, and it says The Blackest Album, and I was like, who's being an asshole? And I turned it over, and it's all Metallica covers from industrial bands.
Didn't Die Krupps, cover a lot of this Metallica stuff?
Did they?
I think so.
See, I've never heard them, but I've heard Napalm Death cover them, so I don't know.
Also, chat brought this up, and just judging by the slight flame war that started, I kind of wanted to get people's opinions real quick. Dragon Force.
Fucking love Dragon Force.
That's like the first quench in the whole fucking night. Wes has been like, hell yeah.
I wouldn't have seen that coming, I'm going to be honest with you. Dragon Force is good. Sort of to me. Dragon Force, I think of the same way as I think of Municipal Waste. I like Municipal Waste a lot. Municipal Waste is a great thrash metal band, but there's a lot of times when I listen to Municipal Waste where it sounds like there are a bunch of people trying to do thrash metal. You know what I mean? It was just like, let's all drink beer, play fast music, and get wasted. Like, I get it, and that's cool. It's a great fast sound, and it was awesome to hear that. That's how I think about Dragon Force. It was shred metal, and I had already been exposed to so many better shred metal bands. Like, I had listened to Cacophony, which is leaps and bounds more talented songwriting than any Dragon, in my opinion, any Dragon Force song. Yeah. But Marty Friedman and what was his name? Jason something or another from Cacophony. Absolutely amazing shred metal almost 20 years before Dragon Force ever became a band. So when I heard Dragon Force, I was like, oh, okay, this stuff's pretty cool. I like shred metal. And then people were blowing up on it, like, holy shit, this band is the most talented. And I'm like, no, I listened to guitarists like in high school that were better than these guys. they're just really good songwriters, and they're kind of derivative of that power metal sound, which a lot of people were doing at that time. There's a band called 3 Inches of Blood.
Three Inches of Blood.
Yeah. So they you know, a lot of people were taking that power metal song. The early hardcore scene, high-pitched power metal vocals out of nowhere started coming into bands. And I think Dragon Force, they were like, let's jump on this. Good band-ish, but not the amazing band that I think a lot of people think they are. There's a lot of people that came before them that were just destroying the kind of music that they're playing right now. You know?
What I like about Dragon Force is that they're fast as shit. That's what I like.
Yeah.
They are super fast. You know, if you listen to... They don't have as aggressive as... Or he doesn't have as aggressive of a sound, but if you listen to, like, Michelangelo Batio... he has, I think it's Baito or Batio, something like that, Baito. He does that kind of shred, thrashy kind of sound. And a lot of his songs will, you know, give you flashbacks of Dragon Force. But he's a much more talented guitar player. A lot of the scales he's doing are a lot more technical and really weird shit. But he's more of like a solo artist, not a lot of vocals. So you won't get your power metal vocal fix there. See, so I was listening to a lot of these shred artists, and then I hear that, and they're like, oh, good, this is a part of this genre. And everybody kind of holds them up as, like, this incredible, like, arbiter of this style of music, and I'm like, ah, nah.
See, for me, they almost became a caricature of the genre, and, like, what I mean by that is Dragon Force is really good. I enjoy the music a lot, you know what I mean? But if I put on a Dragon Force album, I'm not going to be able to tell when one song starts or ends. You know what I mean? And it's sort of like I said, I did the whole jazz ska thing, so I have like kind of a punk background, you know what I mean? Same thing with the Ramones. Fucking love the Ramones. Can't tell when a song starts or ends. You know what I mean? Like, it all just kind of, I mean, I don't want to say it sounds the same, but I mean, it's like the sounds are so similar, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just like throughout the albums, it's like, it's one musical tonality. It's like one texture, you know what I mean?
I could see that, yeah. I think a lot of the Ramones, like, more popular hits are the more different sounding ones, but they're not the better Ramones songs. So yeah, if you put on your typical Ramones album, there's not going to be a lot to where they stop playing 3-bar chords.
And, yeah, you know what I mean.
You know? And then he starts singing about his girlfriend or any other girl who's into him.
Yeah,
nobody was into John Ramone. Come on, he's the ugliest man on planet Earth. Rest in peace, the entirety of the Ramones, because they're all dead. Holy shit!
Oh,
that's pure insanity.
Sadness sweeps the chat. Like,
yeah, that was a dark place to have taken it. Why did I do that?
Yeah, Jesus, just kill the room, man.
You talked about Kurt Cobain and glad he's dead, so I mean, this isn't that much of a stretch.
Am I obsessed with death?
Okay, A, yes, you are, and B, I'm not exactly wildly surprised that somebody talks shit about Kurt Cobain in this podcast. When you're talking with a bunch of metalheads about metal, they're not really going to favorably talk about grunge. So they're not really going to favorably talk
Wes
about
and Jared.
Yeah, like.
See, I liked other grunge bands. It's just
I like Nirvana.
I never got into them. I was listening to heavier stuff when Nirvana came out. I wasn't there for the big when they blew up. I was there more towards the end, like, oh, Heart Shaped Box, that's an all right song. And even when I was like a preteen / teen, I was listening to the lyrics of Heart Shaped Box, and I was like, this dude is so far up his own ass, it's ridiculous. He's just right. This is what I hate about people who are these, like, creative introverts who, like, oh, I hate public, but I'm going to be part of a gigantic band that makes millions of dollars. Is the fucking Kurt Cobain, if you listen to his lyrics, it's absolute nonsense with no meaning to it, but it's nonsense in an artsy, well-placed way.
Mm-hmm.
I wish I could eat your cancer when you turn black. What the fuck does that mean? Nobody has ever... That's a stupid fucking lyric, and it's just some dude who, like, threw a handful of artsy-fartsy magnets at a fridge and said, this is the next song, eat cancer. We got the new hit, it's Heart Shaped Box. It's like a box of shapes like a heart. No one's gonna get it. It's bullshit. Sorry.
No, there's no reason to apologize. You're more
than a lot of this built up.
Yeah, it's just, oh my god, it's just funnier because earlier in the chat I believe it was Wes who said straight edge people are angry as shit, and I said that you're a pretty good example of it.
Pretty much.
Yeah, when you don't do drugs or drink alcohol, you got to get all your problems out by yelling at bands.
Oh yeah, dude,
I don't do that. Drink or drugs, and I don't yell at bands.
Yeah, but whatever. We all know that Nico's side activities are weird enough to make up for it, though.
Probably.
Yeah. Nico is into that spice of life. Nice gesture, Jerry, asshole. My god. Okay, out of curiosity, though, just because we're quickly running out of time, another band that I did want to get everybody's opinion on, just because, once again, not necessarily considered technically a satire band, I believe. I don't necessarily know if they would count otherwise, but The D. I definitely want to talk about Tenacious D. I want to get people's opinion. Yeah. Because I understand it's satire, it's technically comedy, you know, all that shit. But A, amazing fucking live show. Jack Black kills it. And B, man, a lot of that music I actually really get into, like Kickapoo and shit. Like, it's a good sound, man. Yeah. You know what I mean?
That first album is amazing. I love it.
Yeah.
It's so good.
At first, I thought they were like Weird Al Yankovic. You know what I mean? They were just a joke band, and I appreciated that. And going back to when I was on tour, when I was on tour, this was probably like my fifth or sixth tour, the Tenacious D movie, was it Something of Truth?
Pick of Destiny.
That movie had blown up, and we had all seen it, and I had downloaded the soundtrack, and we listened to that for like 36 days straight driving in that van. I didn't think of Tenacious D as like an actual band until I listened to that album, and it's an incredible album, but I don't know if I actually would list them as a band I listen to.
Because it's hard to say, you know what I mean? And it's not to discredit like them as musicians, because honestly, I really do like Tenacious D's music, but it's like designed to be a joke, you know what I mean? Kind of like, and once again, mentioned in chat, Death Clock. I don't know how familiar you guys are with Death Clock's actual music.
I love Death Clock.
But
I love Death Clock, I'm not going to lie. I have two Death Clock shirts, I'm a huge fan.
You know what I mean? Like, that's music I can get into, but do you technically, like, count it as, like, artists and bands? Like, because it's supposed to be satirical, you know what I mean?
I do, in a sense, because... What is his name? Brendan Small? Is that his name? The guy who wrote Home Movies and did Death Clock. He's a really good musician, or at least a good songwriter. He's not the greatest technical guitar player, but he's a good songwriter, and he loves death metal. So his approximations of death metal are close enough that I can actually listen to him and get down with him. Obviously, I'm not a big fan of the vocals. To me, it's almost like somebody making fun of death metal vocals. There's some... You know what I mean? Like, I could sing for Death Clock and be a better vocalist than that, and it'd be more accurate to death metal. But still, to this day, their actual The Death album, I could listen to that all day. That's a killer album for me personally. I think of them as more of a real band than Tenacious D.
Wow, that okay.
Yeah, it's a little weird.
Also, Rewind Mike wanted to know if you like Duncan Hill's coffee.
I love Duncan Hill's coffee. I do vocal warm-ups to Duncan Hill's coffee because that's a good, it's a good, like, high to low range. Yeah, I like Duncan Hill's coffee. You know, but let's talk about this because I didn't even think about it, but I don't know what a lot of you guys feel about grindcore, but there's been a modern kind of reemergence of, like, that grindcore power violence sound. So anybody listen to grindcore?
Not really. What are you considering grindcore?
Like your super fast three cymbal stops and then to blast like beat kind of napalm. Yeah, Gohor to me is more death metal. Grindcore to me, I feel like Napalm Death is your quintessential grindcore band. It's got a death metal sound, but it's very fast. Like, as fast as death metal can be played, but the core or the guitars aren't your typical like really technical rhythm guitars. It's just really fast switching of like bar chords, almost. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, I've always liked Napalm Death. Give me some more examples.
Napalm Death. What you need to do, since we're talking about the reemergence of grindcore, is there's a band called Insect Warfare that you must listen to.
It's a good name.
Insect Warfare.
Insect Warfare. They are fast and disgusting. Just the fastest music. You like that thrash metal sound?
Yeah, it is, oh Christ,
they are so fast, it's insanity. They are brand new grindcore, and this really fast kind of like grindcore power violence sound is making it back, at least in underground, you know, your underground death metal and hardcore scene. But there's a lot of really good fast bands that are coming back that they're not getting the kind of play that they deserve, but they're super good stuff. I don't know if any of you guys have listened to Nails.
No, none of these are bands I'm familiar with, and admittingly, I'm a little surprised.
Nails, very good. It's a very power violence kind of sound, almost like way angrier punk rock. Like if you had grindcore vocals and, I mean, grindcore guitars with hardcore vocals, it's the same idea of like old hardcore punk, how they would cut out the chorus and just get straight to the meat of the song. Mm-hmm. Power violence is like that with grindcore, pretty much. Yeah, listen to Nails. They're really good. Nails is good as fuck. There's just some really good... Trash Talk. Anybody listen to Trash Talk?
No.
That's another power violence band you should probably get into. Super fast stuff, if you like the fast stuff. I guess I'm the only one here who's listening to that stuff, but if anything, anybody who's watching, new grindcore is killing it. New power violence is killing it. Go listen to Nails, Trash Talk, Insect Warfare. I was I'll in check Texas. Out
Insect Warfare, if only because it's a hell of a fucking name.
Oh, God, they are as heavy and fast as they sound. When you think of Insect Warfare, how, like, just destructive it sounds, that's what their music is. It's just pure destruction. And I had a chance to see them, oh, Christ, before they broke up. And I was in Texas, and somebody's like, hey, we're going to this show. You want to come? And I was like, who's playing? Insect Warfare. Never heard of them. Fuck them. And I stayed at this dude's apartment that we were staying at while our van broke down. And I missed out on the last Insect Warfare show.
Oh, that sucks. I've done shit like that too. Passed up a show and then the band's not around anymore.
Yeah, I've done it a bunch of times. It sucks. I need to stop being such a dick.
I would also like to say that Dubious said that grindcore is the auditory equivalent of prolapses. I thought you would appreciate that, so...
Honestly, that's a fairly apt
Maybe that's why it comes with your seal of approval.
There's a lot of like gore bands that are coming back to gore is huge now. Like Wes, you ever listen to any like slam gore bands like Dying Fetus, that really nasty heavy death metal?
I didn't really like Dying Fetus, dude. So if it's like really? That, then I probably wouldn't like it.
Yeah, that style of really nasty, real slow, chunky kind of death metal with real low guttural vocals.
Yeah, that stuff bores me to tears, dude.
That's huge right now. The hardcore scene actually got a hold of it, kind of like death metal, and started playing these slam bands. Slam got huge, and now like nasty guttural fucking grossness is back, and it's cool.
Okay, well, as we're wrapping up, though, because we're getting back to, like, about to that time, if you had to say that there's one quote-unquote metal band that you've really been listening to lately, what would you say it is? Because I would say mine, and I'm sure some people in chat are going to just be like, it's fucking progressive rock, you scrub, fuck you! I've been listening to a lot of Animals as Leader. And, like, I understand...
No, they're heavy metal, for sure.
Yeah,
they're
like, it's heavy as, like, it's heavy as fuck. Which is why I hate it when people are like, dude, that's just prog rock. I'm like, fuck you. Fuck your house. Like, I don't know.
They're heavy. That's definitely heavy metal. It's very progressive and experimental, but that djenty sound is that's still heavy metal to me, at least.
But I think that's why I've been really liking them so much, is because they're so progressive. Like, it is just such a different sound, but it's still just heavy as shit. Also,
Remind me when we get done. I have some bands I want you to listen to if you like them.
Yeah, please, by all means, but... What about you? Who would you say is the one band you're really listening to, Jared, nowadays?
Oh, man. All right, so can I say two bands? Because I've never listened to one band ever.
Fine, say two bands.
If I'm listening to two bands right now, this band called Black Tongue, super heavy. The music genre they get into has kind of been mislabeled as beatdown. I don't know if Wes listens to a lot of that New York beatdown kind of hardcore, like Billy Club Sandwich, any bands like that. It's mislabeled like that. A lot of people call it downtempo. It's real slow, heavy hardcore. It's very rhythmic, and the riffs almost kind of like stoner metal. If you listen to like a Sword song, very rhythmic sound, it's like that tuned to fucking the heaviest tuning a guitar can go to on like a fucking seven.
Yeah, I probably wouldn't like it.
I wouldn't blame you. They're super heavy and nasty, but they're just really gross and good lyrics. And between them and Dark Funeral, it's kind of an older album. I gotta look at it now. Angelus X-Zero Pro Internus. It's super fast black and thrash. Really nasty, dark, fast thrash metal. Not thrash metal, black and thrash. Black metal with a thrash tone.
Dude, this labeling, it's fucking horrible. It's like it's anything electronic or like metal. It's just like, how do you fucking label this? Like, if it's not pop, it's like, what do you call it? You know what I mean?
Imagine Dumu Borgir and, I don't know, any other death metal band get together. The dark nastiness and like tremolo picked dark riffs from Dumu Borgir played over a constant blast beat that doesn't end until the song ends. That's how I would describe Black and
Thrash. All right. I love blast beats, but when it's too much, it just loses its effect.
I can understand
that. That's one of the issues I have with black metal.
Yeah, I can see that.
Well, what about you, Wes? If you were to say you were picking one or two metal bands nowadays that you've been listening to, who would you say?
Shit, man, that's so hard, dude, because I listen to a different band every day.
That's fair. That's fair. Just to plug a few in case people want to go look something up after this.
Well, I've been going back into my classic, like, thrash stuff, dude. Like, Forbidden, Violence.
Violence is super good.
Yeah, Violence is excellent. Everyone should check out Violence. But one band that they only released two albums, but everyone should check them out, is Acid Bath.
Yeah, Acid Bath is weird.
Cool. Dude, they're from Louisiana, like the Bayou, Louisiana. So they got like that sound mixed with like death metal with like really melodic southern vocals. Yeah. And the musicians are just they're all fantastic, dude. And the cool thing is that they use their two albums. The first album, When the Kite String Pops, it's an actual picture that John Wayne Gacy painted.
Oh, shit.
Pogo the Clown. And then their second album, Pagan Terrorism Tactics, is a painting done by Dr. Kevorkian.
Jesus. If you're going for album covers, though, there you go, man.
Boom.
So, but both of those albums, like, I don't know, dude. You just got, you would have to check it out. They're both over 20 years old now, 20 plus years, but
Acid Bath, that's your vote?
Good stuff.
I'll have to check it out when it comes with that high of a praise, absolutely. What about you, Nico? And I'm not going to get mad if you say Budgie, but...
No. I mean, there are a lot of bands that I, you know, listen to. There are a lot of the, you know, older 70s, 80s. Now, but I actually have picked up, recently listening to all the albums from this band that, I don't know, for me, I consider metal just based on the sound. May not really, you guys may not consider this metal, this band, but Rage Against the Machine.
Yeah, I can see that for sure.
Yeah, that's them. Like, I picked up their, you know, their first album, Evil Empire and The Battle of Los Angeles. I really dig the first album.
I would call them metal for sure. Yeah, they're super heavy.
Empire. They may not have like fast rhythms or like anything like that, but their sound is just heavy.
For sure.
Evil Empire there's a down in Denver. There's a record store by the Ogden Theater, and it's like a secondhand record store. And the first concert I ever went to the Ogden, I went by that record store in Evil Empire.
Talking about independent records?
Yeah. And the first time
Angelo's now.
Yeah, when I went in there, Evil Empire was the first CD I picked up. That was great. That was fucking sweet. But last couple quick notes, just because chat is blowing up. Jared, I'm supposed to ask you if you've listened to Ed Gein.
Yeah, Ed Gein's pretty cool.
And then
weird.
The other thing too, just because I did want to throw this in because Dubious has brought them up four times, is I also wanted to mention Ghost. I don't know if you guys have listened to Ghost. Yeah. Ghost is some good shit. My feeling on Ghost, though, in all seriousness, is I love the sound. It's super weird, but I legitimately think that if you were to summon the devil, that's what you would listen to. Like, legitimately. I'm not saying, like, it's super evil or it's heavy and fast or violent or anything like that. I'm just saying it is, like, it legitimately sounds like just monks just, like, summoning the fucking devil.
I like the idea of Ghost. I like how they started off playing, like, almost 60s rock and roll, and they just wanted to be super palatable so children could learn about Satan so they wouldn't be turned away by the heavy metal sound. Even though their new album is fairly fucking heavy, Ghost is cool, man. I had a chance to see them, and I just didn't have any money. I wish I would have went.
Yeah, the first time I'd ever heard them, they were playing a show at the Fox in Boulder, and this was when Dubious was out here, and he was living at the house with me. He was, like, living in my property, you know? And he's like, yeah, dude, Ghost is coming to town, and we've just been getting tons of petitions from the churches to not let them play. Like, that's all we get all day, is that if they come, we're going to unleash the devil or something like that, so... Damn, I'm excited to check out... I'm excited to check out that show, like... But yeah, I definitely did want to mention those. And then also quickly, I don't know if you guys have heard it or not, but do you remember the game Brutal Legend? Did any of you play it?
Nope.
Okay. Nope. No comment on the game, but it is my favorite licensed soundtrack of all time. The metal on that soundtrack is fucking fantastic.
So you know what has a great soundtrack is Splatterhouse.
Hell yeah.
And the new recent Doom.
Yeah, that is a really cool kind of like progressive experimental metal soundtrack. That's some good tracks on the Doom soundtrack.
Yeah, I still need to play the new Doom.
Can I do this though? My friend, he has this band called Infant Annihilator, and I gotta shout them out because they're super good. Infant Annihilator. If you listen to like kind of gore slam / technical death metal, you gotta go check out Infant Annihilator. My friend just started doing lead vocals for them, and if you like songs like Newborn Porn, Devotion to the Child Rape Syndicate, my personal favorite, Anal Prolapse Suffocation. If you listen to gross, nasty, gore metal, go check out Infant Annihilator. My buddy is a lead singer, and he's super cool. Got nasty low vocals. If you get into death metal, you'll probably get into them.
Fantastic. Well, as we're wrapping up now, this is where I like to give everyone a chance to plug in their social media, projects, etc., etc. So why don't we go ahead and start with you, Jared?
I'm Jared from Avalanche Reviews. You can find me at Twitter, at Avalanche Jared, J-A-R-E-D. And on my YouTube channel, Avalanche Reviews. Not a lot of metal on that channel. I'm going to have to change that now that we're talking about it.
I'm surprised you're not plugging any of the No Mercy, but...
Oh, yeah, fuck that. Maybe not. I don't want to get kicked off of YouTube, too.
All right. Well, what about you, Wes?
Well, you can find me on Twitter, Westapo666, spelled just like Gestapo, but with a W. And then my YouTube channel is just Westapo. And I just recently released today a video of Super Metroid versus Metroid Fusion, comparing the two, which is the better game. So if you're interested in that, definitely check it out. I put a lot of work into that video. So
yeah, and I was actually going to plug that too because I watched it this morning. And not to sound like a dick, but it was a good video. I was like impressed. Like it was really enjoyable. So people should definitely check that out if they haven't.
Right on. Thanks.
What about you, Nico?
Hey, I'm Nico, the Wii guy. If you search the Wii guy, you...
Jesus.
What?
Sorry, just I'm the Wii guy. Hey, I'm
he turned into the Wii guy immediately.
Just like flip the fucking switch.
I'm Nico, the Wii guy. If you search the Wii guy, you should find my Twitter and Facebook and links to Wii Guy 39, my YouTube channel for 8-bit stereo, but also Gaming Going Gone, where I house other reviews like Play the Game and the aptly titled Can You Force It? Which, I've got new episodes. I did a new session for Can You Force It, so I'll have in some new episodes playing with the U-Force.
And it's not porn or rape in any way, because that's
it's
what
the U-Force
like.
Peripheral for the NES, Jared.
It's family-friendly entertainment, dagnammit. Don't try to throw your prolapse views into this. Stay out of it. Keep Nico clean. Anyways, before we open up that can of worms, as for myself, you can always reach me over at Twitter at NA1i. I'm super easy to get a hold of there. Stream with my buddy Veritech 4 days out of the week, so you can find me on one of our channels. My Twitch is Hots1eye. His is VeritechGG, I believe. And then also, once a week on Fridays, I do a podcast called The Guardians, which is an Overwatch-focused content. We cover competitive, casual, stuff like that. This week's episode should be pretty good because Blizzard's been doing an alternate reality game based around the next hero that they're releasing. So there's going to be a lot of tinfoil hat and all sorts of conspiracy shit going on this week's episode. So you can check that over at VeritechGG on YouTube Gaming or Twitch. Fridays, I want to say it's at 6 Mountain, so that's 8 Eastern, right? That sounds about right. That sounds like time zones. So
sure.
Can find me there. As far as my guests are concerned, Jared, thank you for joining us for 3 weeks. When I gave you that list, I was very surprised that you're like, yes, all of them. Give me all of them. So it's been an absolute pleasure having you on.
They've all been fun, man. Fuck yeah.
Yeah, thanks, it's been good. Me. There are a few more I'm going to talk to you about, too, because we have arcade memories coming up here soon and things like that. So will be good. Yeah. And then Nico and Wes, I just literally... Nico, thank you for stepping in, by the way. It's very much appreciated. But you guys are like the Multitap music podcasters, so it's really fantastic to have you join me as well. Especially
anytime,
Wes.
Anytime, man.
I like seeing you get all fired up about metal. I know that you're an old school metalhead, so it was fun just seeing you fuck all this new shit. Like, it was great. It was a fun episode. So,
hell yeah, for sure.
Thank you to the viewers who are watching us live. Thank you to everyone who's catching us on iTunes. And I want to say Spreaker, but I could be wildly wrong. Anyways, I know we do YouTube uploads and iTunes upload. So there for sure, and watching us live. And then we will see you guys next week.